income diagram.
See, this diagram will help you to find out the best reducing agent. That is why this diagram is important. See, you understand, in case of pyrometallurgy, the main mechanism is called either smelting or reduction, if you remember. Reduction means the oxide will become metal, right? This is called reduction. Or your sulfide will become metal, or your chloride will become metal, because we have three main types of ore. One is oxide ore, second one is sulfide, and third one is the halide ore, right? Halide means basically chloride, I have told you, right? So if you are converting your metal oxide into metal, that is reduction. If you are converting your metal chloride into metal, that is also reduction. If you are converting metal sulfide into metal, that is also reduction, right? That is called simply reduction. But if you get a liquid metal out of a metal oxide, if you get liquid metal out of metal sulfide, if you get liquid metal out of metal chloride, so that is smelting. So smelting means, you understand, that is a operation which combines two processes. One is reduction and the other one is the melting. Both things will happen, right? So that means the end product of the smelting process will be a liquid metal. A starting raw material is your any oxide or sulfide or your chloride. It is okay? We have understood, right? So this diagram will help you to find out the best reducing agent, because we can have a lot of reducing agent. And let me clear one point. We can use hydrogen as a reducing agent, right? Hydrogen can reduce the metal oxide into metal, right? We can use carbon as a reducing agent, and we can use some other metals to reduce the metal oxide into metal. This is the situation otherwise. Metal oxide, carbon, metal oxide, hydrogen, metal oxide, or you can have any other metal, for example, M2. These are four. These are the reducing agents. Either you can use carbon, you can use hydrogen, you can use any other metals. But can you tell me which one will be expensive? The last one, obviously, because you have to consume a metal to reduce this metal oxide. The product will be what? M1 plus M2O. Suppose this is not balanced one, this one will be M1 plus, suppose H2O. Can balance it, right? And this one will be M plus Pu. This is the thing. But expensive one will be the metal one. Obviously, you have to sacrifice a metal to extract another metal. And you have to remember, this kind of process is called metallothermic reduction. Why? Because we are using another metal to extract a metal out of a metal oxide. Right? So here, that means in other simple way you can say, metallothermic reduction is that kind of reduction where we are using another metal, right, to extract our metal of interest, this one. Condition will be what? Can anybody guess? The condition will be, this M2 should be more reactive. Listen carefully, this M2 should be more reactive toward oxygen, right? Or in another way I can say what? If I will talk about stability, then M2O should be more stable. See, two things are there. This is metal and this is metal oxide. Right? This is metal oxide, this is metal oxide. Listen carefully, this is very interesting. This is metal oxide and this is metal oxide. So why M2O is forming? Why? Because M2 is more reactive compared to M1 towards oxygen. That's why. That is first part. That is in terms of reactivity. So M2 is more reactive as compared to M1, right? In reactive. But if somebody will ask you about the stability of oxide, then what do you say? M2 oxide is more stable as compared to M1 oxide, right? It is okay? So that means, since M2 is forming more stable oxide, that's why M2 is taking away the oxygen from M1. You understand my point? since M2 will form more stable oxide, it will take away the oxygen from M1. That is the main principle behind the metallothermic reduction. But metallothermic reduction problem is what? It will be expensive. Because you are losing M2. That means it is becoming an oxide. That is a loss. Right? And basically M2 are more expensive as compared to M1. Why? Because M2 is reactive. Reactive metals are more costly. Obviously, right? If you compare the calcium and aluminium, obviously calcium is more reactive. Calcium is costly. Right? If you compare lithium and aluminium, obviously lithium is more costly. Lithium is more reactive. Right? Suppose I am talking about magnesium and aluminium. Magnesium is more expensive. But they are more reactive. More reactive metals, more expensive. So that means you have to lose some costly metals here. So that is the main limitation of this. But advantage you will get is what? You will get a metal which will be free from carbon. That means this metal will be, M1 metal will be free from carbon, because we are not using any kind of carbon. But here in this case, in the first case, you may get metal containing some dissolved carbon, which happens in case of iron. In iron extraction, we'll end up with iron containing some dissolved carbon in it. 3.5 to 4% carbon will be dissolved in it. Right? So you can say, this is kind of pure metal, right? But this is an impure metal. And this kind of reaction is called, can it be this? Carbothermic reduction. Why? Because we are using carbon as a reducing agent. You understand my point? Here carbon is the main reducing agent. Carbon is reducing the metal oxide into metal. So this is called carbothermic. Thermic word means, in this process, heat is evolved. Heat is getting released due to the reaction. So that's why it is called thermic. Right? So metallothermic means metal is used as a reducing agent. Thermic means heat is released. Due to this reaction, some heat will release. Right? Similarly, in carbothermic reduction, some heat will release. So that's why carbothermic. Right? But advantage of carbothermic reduction is, it is very cheap, very economical. Why? Carbon is plentifully available in nature. Right? But problem is what? The main problem is you'll end up with metal containing dissolved carbon. Carbon impurities will come in. Right? And the problem is pollution problem, obviously, because it will evolve, CO will evolve or CO2 will evolve. That will create the environmental pollution. Air pollution will be there. Right? But this is very expensive because carbon is plentifully available in nature. So basically carbon means we can use coal or we can use coke. For iron extraction, you basically use coke. That is the main reducing agent, coke. What is the difference between coal and coke? You understand, right? Which one is stronger, coal or coke? Coke is very strong. It will not break easily. And what about calorific value? Calorific value of coke is very high. When it will burn, it will release lot of heat. The temperature can go to a very high temperature if you are using coke. Because in case of coal, you have lot of ash content. Right, lot of volatile metals content will be there in coal, and it is very weak, fragile. If you drop a coal, it will break. But if you drop a coke, it will not break. It can withstand a lot of load. It can sustain. Right. Anyways, so and this one is very interesting. Why can it be? What is the interesting over here? Just look at this one. You get water, and water is not a pollutant. So if you are using hydrogen as a reducing agent, the benefit is what? Pollution will be not there. Because the end product is what? Water molecule. But problem is what? Hydrogen is not plentifully available in earth crust, or it is very difficult to get hydrogen. Hydrogen is obtained by electrolysis process, you know that. If you do electrolysis of water, you will get hydrogen, but that is an expensive process. And another problem is what? Hydrogen is somewhat like explosive. If you cannot handle it properly, explosion will be there. So this some problem with this one. So basically either we do this one or we do this one, but in industry we follow this one. Why? Because carbon is plentifully available. So in Ellingham diagram we have a line called CO line. We'll see that. That is a very interesting line actually. A lot of significance is there in case of CO line. And we have what? We have metals and metal oxide also in Ellingham diagram. See, Ellingham diagram can be for metal oxide, it can be drawn for metal sulfide also, it can be drawn for metal chloride also. they are different diagrams, but concept is same. That is delta G naught versus temperature. That's all. In y axis we have delta G naught. Delta, many people did mistake like this. They write delta G, but that is wrong actually. You have to write delta G naught. Standard change in free energy of formation of a compound. Here compounds are what? Either oxide or chloride or sulfide. Right? When a compound is forming, what is delta G naught? What is the free energy of formation? Or change in free energy of formation. Now I'll draw a diagram here. So you understand what is Ellingham diagram? Ellingham diagram is a plot between delta G naught. Delta G naught is what? This is standard change in free energy of formation of a compound. It is okay? And this is versus temperature. Temperature is basically in degree centigrade. We take temperature. And many people did mistake. One point they did mistake is they write delta G. If you write delta G, it is wrong completely. You have to write delta G now, right? And the people did mistake is this plot actually starts from zero. Basically, we start writing zero from here. But I am talking about delta G naught values. You write 0, then from 100, 200 like this. This is wrong picture. This plot starts from 0 from the top. This is 0, delta G naught. Right? Then if you go down, it will be negative and more negative and more negative. Suppose I am writing this is 0. This is I am writing minus 100. Then I am writing minus 200. These are not exact values. These are for explanation. This is suppose minus 300. This is minus 400. This is minus 500. This is minus 600. This is minus 700. This is minus 800, for example. Right? Suppose this is end up at 900. Minus 900. Right? So what you are getting? You are getting that delta G naught value is 0 here, but when you go down, it is more negative. The magnitude is increasing in this direction, but it is in negative direction. Right? Similarly, temperature is but same thing. Temperature starts from 0 towards high temperature. So what is 0? For example, this is 200, this is 400, this is 600, this is 800 degrees centigrade, this is 1000. So this is 1400. Suppose this is 12, you can write. This is 1400. Suppose this is 1600, this is 1800. And suppose this is 2000, fine. This is clear up to this? The temperature is increasing in this direction, but delta G naught value is increasing in this direction, but negative delta G naught value, right? Now in the Ellingham diagram we have, suppose I want to draw Ellingham diagram for oxides. So I have what? I have a metal and I have oxygen, and it is reacting with one another and forming metal oxide. Three things are there: metal, oxygen, metal oxide, right? But we take some assumptions. What is the assumption? We always try to react the metal with one mole of oxygen. That is the main criteria. Right? Metal should react with one mole of oxygen. And you have to remember another interesting point. Metal should be in solid state. It should be pure. Completely pure metal, and it should be in solid state. And oxygen here is the gases obviously. But one mole of oxygen. And final product which will obtain is metal oxide. That metal oxide should be also in solid state. Basically, we assume. Right? So, we will have these kind of lines, if you remember. These kind of lines we have. These are not exact lines, but this is for explanation. Right? So, we have these kind of lines. These kind of lines, suppose I am writing M plus oxygen. It is forming MO. M1. This is M1, right? This line is for M2 plus O. Suppose this is M2O. These are not balanced, but for explanation I am adding. This is M3 plus O. This is M3O, right? This is M4 plus O. This is M4. This is M5 plus O. This is M5O. This is O. M M6O, then final this is M7 plus O, this is M7. So this M1, M2, M3 all are metals, pure metals in solid state. And these are 1 mole of oxygen. Like I told you, 1 mole of oxygen you have to use. For simplicity actually you are assuming. And finally these are oxides, respective oxides. So this is solid, this is gas, this is solid. Right? Products are solids, reactants are solids, but this oxygen is the gas phase. It is okay up to this? Fine. Now the question is, why the lines are moving up? You can see, this is the temperature axis, right? With increasing in the temperature, the line is moving up. And all are basically straight lines. Yes or no? This is the feature you have seen in the diagram, right? So question is, why this metal oxide formation line are moving up? And there is another line, we'll discuss that. The line is this one, for example. What is this line? Let me see who remember. CO2 line, very good. So we have C plus, suppose O2, CO2 for example. Fine? And another interesting line we have, that is, suppose CO line, very good. So this is suppose 2C plus. Okay, right? This is okay now? Yes. This is okay? So now you can see, first point is why these metal oxide lines are moving up, why this carbon dioxide line is straight, and why this carbon monoxide line is moving down. That is obviously a question. Can anybody answer? Why these metal oxides are line moving up? Yes. Increasing. Okay. Okay. Anyways, let me explain this one. This equation is well known to everyone. Yes or no? This equation is well known to everyone. Delta G naught is equal to delta H naught plus T delta S naught. This is the relationship between change in free energy with entropy, temperature and enthalpy. All are in standard condition. Why? This is delta G naught. That's why this is delta G naught, right? So if I write Y, I can write like this, Y is equal to mx plus p. Why? Because all the lines are straight. Listen carefully. In this diagram, all lines are straight. So I am comparing this equation with a straight line equation. Y is equal to mx plus c. So you understand what is c? C is the intercept. This one is slope. So if I will take, okay, fine. And another interesting point you have to remember, entropy basically depends upon the gaseous molecules or gaseous moles. See, if you remember, if you measure the entropy of a solid, liquid and gas, so maximum entropy will be in case of gaseous phase, then liquid, then solid. So basically, we consider entropy for liquid and gas is negligible here, right? Basically. So entropy will only depends upon the how much number of molecules or how much number of moles of gaseous phase are present. It is okay? Only depend upon the number of moles. If, see, we have reactants, we have products. So we have to check how entropy is changing, basically. This is minus or plus? Minus. You are not saying anything right. This is minus. Delta G naught is equal to delta H naught minus T delta S. So C is delta H naught, fine. What is M? What is M? Minus T or minus? Negative value of change in standard entropy. It is okay? M is minus delta S naught, fine. Now, suppose I'll start with this one, for example. m1 plus o give rise to m1 o. Why this line is straight and why this line is moving up? That is my question. So if I have line m1, this is what? Solid. Listen carefully. Then oxygen is? Yes. It will give rise to m1 o. m1 o is solid again. This is solid, this is gas, this is solid. Due to this reaction, this is happening. So I told entropy depends upon only number of moles of gaseous phase. So you can see this is reactants and this is product, right? So now you can see this is one, yes or no, one mole of. So in this left side, we have one gaseous mole. But in the right side, we don't have any kind of gaseous moles. Only solid is present. But in reactant side, we have one gaseous mole. So due to this reaction, what is happening to the entropy? Decreasing? Obviously. Because left side, we have gaseous phase. But right side, we do not have any gaseous phase. Here I can write one mole of gas. Zero mole of gas. Is okay? Fine? So due to this reaction, entropy is decreasing, right? So if you want to find out change in entropy, so change in entropy will be how much? Entropy of the product minus entropy of the reactant, obviously, yes or no? Change in entropy. So it will be coming negative or positive? Tell me quickly. Negative. Why? Because this is less, this is, okay. It will be coming as positive or negative? Tell me quickly. This is product minus reactant. What is slope? Slope is equal to m, right? And here it is coming as negative because delta S naught is the slope. It is coming as negative, but already we have a negative sign. So what will happen? Negative into negative, it will become. You understood? We are getting a negative del S naught, but already we have a m is equal to minus del S naught. So minus into minus, it will become plus. So plus means, I told, slope is what? This is the slope. Suppose this is the line, slope is this one. That means the slope is increasing or it is going to the positive direction. We have a positive slope. It is okay, so that's why this is positive. You can measure for m2 also. M2 plus o gives rise to m2. Same thing will come, you can see. Suppose I am replacing this one, m2. Then I am writing, this is m2o. What will happen to the delta S naught? Again negative. And already we have a negative minus delta S naught. So negative, negative become positive. So again this line is moving up. Why? The slope is increasing. If you have understood, you take any lines. And what interesting point we are getting? The interesting point we are getting is the stability of the oxide is decreasing with increasing in the temperature. Right? How? This is very simple. Suppose this is the line. Listen carefully, this is the line. Line is moving up. And this is the temperature axis. So, suppose when temperature is 0, this is how much? It is, suppose, minus 850. I am writing here. 0 degree centigrade, we have minus 850. Delta G naught is minus 850, right? But if I will take a temperature of this much, for example, 1000 degree. So how to measure the delta G naught again? Just draw a line to this line, right? Then you understood? Now for 1000 degree centigrade, delta G naught value is this much. How much it is? So at 1000 degree, it is how much? Minus 700. Now compare the two points. At low temperature, it is 850, but at high temperature, it is becoming minus 700. So what changes you are getting? Which one? At what temperature it is more stable? Minus 850. You have to remember, more is negative value of delta G naught, more is the stability. That is the point. Right? More is the negative value of delta G naught, more is the stability of that particular compound. Here, that is oxide. Similarly, suppose you want to measure at 1400. So, what you can do? You just draw a line. It is here. And you can see how much. So now at 1400, it is how much? Minus 600. You can see the figures. So maximum negative value is this one at low temperature. Then with increasing the temperature, what is happening? Delta G naught value become less negative. It is becoming less negative. That means the oxide is becoming less stable with increasing in the temperature. So that is the main basis of pyrometallurgy. As I told, in pyrometallurgy what we do? We take the ore to a high temperature and it will become unstable. Finally, it will give rise to a metallic phase and non-metallic phase. So that is why we are taking the ore to a high temperature. What will happen? It becomes unstable. Once the ore becomes unstable, or this oxide becomes unstable, it will release the metal out of that. But it is not easy. Why? Because you have to go to a very high temperature. That is not economical. So that's why carbon monoxide line will help you in that. So now we'll discuss about the CO line, CO2 line, then CO line. So here I can write. I can write why the CO2 line is straight. So I can write C plus O2. This is CO2, right? So this is gas phase. This is gas. This is solid. Right? Solid, gas and gas. This is one mole. This is also one mole. So you can see in the left side we have one mole of gas. In the right side also we have one mole of gas. So the entropy is not changing. And entropy is what? The slope. M. Right? So that's why this line is straight. There is no change in entropy due to formation of carbon monoxide. If you find out the minus delta S not value, there will be no change. It is okay? So that's why the line is parallel to the temperature axis. With change in temperature, there is no change in entropy. Because in reactant side and product side, we have same mole of gas phase. Similarly, you can find out this one for CO, carbon monoxide. This is very simple. So I can write 2CO, this is 2C, this is solid, and next is O2, gas, and it will give rise to. Now you check the number of moles. In the reactant side, we have one mole of oxygen only, one mole of gas phase. But in the product side, we have more moles, 2 moles. So what is happening to the entropy? Entropy is increasing. So if you measure the change in entropy, delta S naught, product minus reactant, so it will be coming as positive. Yes or no? Positive or no? So positive, here it is negative. Positive negative becomes negative. That means slope will decrease with increasing in the temperature. That's why the carbon monoxide line is moving down. It has a negative slope. You understood now? Why this line is moving up? Why this line is moving down? Everybody have understood?
Yes.
Yeah. And another point you have to remember is metal oxide is becoming unstable with increasing in the temperature. That is very interesting point. Now you people should understand how to choose a better reducing agent. As I told, we can choose carbon as a reducing agent, right? But carbon is also a very good reducing agent. It is not like that carbon is easily available, plentily available. But carbon is a very good reducing agent. How? Just look at the line of the carbon monoxide. This line is cutting all metal oxide line. Yes or no? Maximum metal oxide line is cut by this one. Suppose I am taking this one. M1O, right? I am taking M1O and I am comparing this line. So they are intersected by this point. So this point is nothing but the equilibrium point. If you take a furnace, furnace means which can rise the temperature, right? If you take a furnace, you put M1O and you put carbon, right? You put carbon into it and you maintain a temperature of this much. What will happen? The reaction will be in equilibrium. You will not get any kind of metal. Suppose you maintain a temperature of this much, 1000 degree. So can you tell me the reaction will happen or not? It will never happen. Why? Just look at the delta G naught value. At 1000 degree centigrade, look at the delta G naught value. Which one is more stable? Carbon monoxide is more stable or the M1O is more stable at this temperature? M1 O. How? Because you have to draw a line up to this point, then from here to here. So at 1000 degree centigrade, delta G naught value for this line is minus 701. Yes? But for carbon monoxide line, you have to go up, then you have to come to this one. It is how much? Minus 500. So you can check, at 1000 degree centigrade, for metal M1O, delta G naught value is minus 700. But for same temperature, for carbon monoxide line, it is minus 500. So more negative is for M1O. So M1O is still stable, but carbon monoxide is not stable. That's why carbon cannot form carbon monoxide at that temperature. Suppose you maintain a temperature of 600, for example. You also find out, at 600, what is the value? For M1O, it is minus 800. For carbon monoxide, you can see. You see, suppose this one, minus 400. So what you are getting? M1O is still stable. But do just opposite thing. What you do? You, this is the equilibrium temperature I told, right? You maintain a temperature of, suppose, 1600. And you find out what is the delta G naught value. So delta G naught value for these two lines is, you can see, this is for carbon monoxide. How much? Suppose this is coming as minus 850. But for this one, sorry, for this one it is, suppose, coming as this one here. Now the reaction is feasible. Why? Because that at 1600, for carbon monoxide, delta G naught value is more negative, minus 850. But for M1O it is how much? Suppose minus 550. Which one is more negative? Minus 850 is more negative. That is for carbon monoxide. That means now in this situation, if you take a furnace, you put carbon and you put M1O at temperature is 1600. So what will happen? Carbon monoxide is more stable. So carbon will take away the oxygen from the M1O. It will form more stable oxygen. So now the reduction is possible. You can reduce the M1O at 1600 degrees centigrade. So that means this Ellingham diagram will help you to find out the temperature of reduction. You people have understood now? You can choose any, suppose you want to reduce, suppose M7O by carbon monoxide. Oh, so sorry, suppose M4O by carbon monoxide, this line. So can you tell me the temperature, at what temperature M4O can be reduced by carbon? So you have to find out the equilibrium temperature first. So M4O line is this one, carbon monoxide line is this one. So the intersection point is the equilibrium temperature. You draw this one, this is the equilibrium temperature. So you have to maintain a temperature above the equilibrium temperature, right? Suppose you maintain a temperature of 1000 degrees centigrade, the reaction will be feasible. The carbon will take away the oxygen from M4O. How? You can explain it by drawing the projection. Yes or no? So at M4O you can draw it. Suppose 1000 degrees centigrade, you draw a line to carbon monoxide. This is the point. This will be how much? Minus 500 for carbon monoxide. And for M4O it is how much? It is minus 400. So which one is more negative? For carbon monoxide is more negative, minus 500. So carbon monoxide is more stable. Right? So you can understand how beneficial Ellingham diagram is. Ellingham diagram also helps us to find out the temperature of reduction. Just by looking at the Ellingham diagram, you can find out the temperature of reduction. If you are choosing carbon as a reducing agent and you are choosing any metal oxide, you can easily find out it. Just you have to look into the intersection point. And you have to maintain a temperature above the intersection point or equilibrium temperature. Temperature should be greater than equilibrium temperature. It is okay? Similarly, yes? Okay, you can leave. Okay, you can pause it.